Our gardens can be places of rich diversity, both vertebrate and invertebrate. And among those invertebrates are ants. Generally speaking, they're friends in the garden. They're seed sowers, and they can play a vital role in breaking down organic matter and burying it in the soil. Australia is home to thousands of species of ant, and of all the states and territories, Queensland is home to the most diverse range. However, there is an invasive, aggressive foreign ant which poses a significant threat. Red fire ants were first identified in Queensland in 2001, thought to have arrived via a cargo shipping container from North America. Red fire ants, Solenopsis invicta, are considered among the worst invasive species in the world.
We actually have an ability to track them. We monitor.
Marni Manning is helping lead our battle against this unwanted visitor with the National Fire Ant Eradication Program.
The fire ant stands to cause a greater ecological damage than cane toads, camels, feral pigs, foxes, feral cats and feral dogs all combined.
So this is a super risk.
It is a super risk. It's not called a super pest for nothing. So it's recognised globally as one of the world's worst.
So what's at risk?
What's at risk is the Australian way of life. And it's not being alarmist. We've got a huge amount of information from countries who have failed or given up the eradication dream. And they actually show us in a clear example of how much they lose their outdoor lifestyle. So the way we enjoy our outdoor barbecues, picnics with the family, all of that is put at risk by this super pest.
What is the sort of damage that they cause?
Well, the United States probably has the most documented damage. They've had fatalities of humans due to anaphylactic response. They've had deaths of livestock and other vertebrate animals. They've had to barbecue in wading pools so that they can actually enjoy the outdoor lifestyle in areas like Texas. They've had to close public facilities like this one where there's playgrounds.
Marni is clear about the nature of the threat posed by these tiny terrors and just what's at stake. What are the implications for our environment and for our wildlife?
Fire ants, if they're disturbed, they will immediately, as a behavioural characteristic, attack and sting and bite. So koalas, when they come down in mating season in particular and might move between trees and they're on the ground, they actually are susceptible to fire ants. We're also concerned about other iconic species like the echidna, the platypus, turtles, for example. We have seen impacts here in Australia on turtles moving between ponds. They're unbelievable in terms of attacking in mass and particularly attacking anything that's slow moving. We know that the ant is probably able to inhabit around about 95 to 97% of our country.
Wow.
Which is much more than what they have in other countries. So the astronomical impacts for us are completely magnified.
So how do they spread?
They spread by flight. It's called a nuptial flight. They'll come after rain particularly and do a mating flight and then they'll spread.
Not all fire ants are capable of flight. Only the fertile males and females, also known as alates, have wings. They mate mid-flight and the females are the future colony's queens.
There can be multiple queens in this nest. That's a characteristic of the fire ants. So you'll see multiple colony establishments coming from that flight. The flights can go up to 5 kilometres. The biggest risk for us at this particular time in our eradication effort is human-assisted movement. These are great hitchhiker pests, so pot plants, pots, soil, turf, mulch, that's where these guys love to be. So they're quite good at actually hitchhiking and moving beyond our containment barrier.
Recent extreme Queensland weather events have provided another highly effective way for fire ants to travel further afield.
Here comes more rafting fire ants.
By forming rafts with their bodies, they can survive and travel on floodwaters while protecting their queens and build new nests when the waters recede.
For Greg Lockie, the floods brought an unwelcome guest, his property now infested with fire ants.
So what are the characteristics of a fire ant?
One, they're a coppery colour with a darker abdomen. Secondly, you'll always see a whole range of different sizes in the one ant, and that's something that's characteristic to the fire ant. So you'll see quite large ones, anywhere up to 5 mils, right down to the very small ones, which are around about 2 mils. And one of the most easily identifiable characteristics is at all when they're disturbed, they immediately come out aggressively towards you. They will just keep coming and coming and coming at whoever or whatever has disturbed them.
Why are they called fire ants?
Well, I've actually been stung myself, and I think it's a very apt name. So they all sting in mass, and it is actually like burning fire on your skin.
Wow. Marnie's team has identified 2 fire ant nests in this public park, so we can observe this invasive threat up close.
We're entering into a children's playground now, which is a concern for us. And we can see right near the path the very first example of quite a pronounced fire ant nest. You can tell that it's a fire ant's nest because it's quite messy. Uh-huh. It doesn't have a defined entry and exit point like a lot of Australian species of ants will have. And they build up after rain, and they do that in a very purposeful response to make sure that they control the temperature to protect the queen. If I disturbed that, though, at the moment, you'd see them come out like a larva.
So this is more what I was expecting to see. It's slightly smaller, but in rough grass.
This one is less pronounced. And yes, you're right. This probably is what people would notice in their grass. It doesn't necessarily have to be with this type of grass, but these are some of the things you will notice, particularly after rain. And that's when we ask home gardeners in particular to really look, because after rain is when they respond like this.
Fortunately, there is something home gardeners can do to stop the march of fire ants.
The best thing to do is ring and report them. And there's 2 ways you can do that. One is through our fire ant website, which is fireants.org.au. And the other way is through our new dedicated hotline, which is 132ANT, or 13 22 68. And that's actually staffed by people who know about fire ants and can talk to you about the identification.
Okay. If you identify a fire ant nest on your property, the task force will mail you out a pesticide to sprinkle around the nest to eradicate the ants.
It's called Reef Away. It's using an active ingredient called indoxacarb, which is a fast-acting ingredient. And you'll actually also receive a whole range of instructions on how to do it as well.
So this is a bait that lures them?
Correct.
You just put a band around there, not on the nest.
No, we don't need to put it onto the nest. And also, we try and tell people not to disturb the nest and risking any type of bites. Oh, look at them all coming now.
As these nests have been found in a high-risk public area, Marni has called an eradication officer to the site to apply a fast-acting direct nest injection of insecticide. How do you find out if you live in a fire ant suppression area?
The best way is to go to our website, and you can actually enter your address.
If you live within the suppression area of southeast Queensland, as I do, you can help stop the spread, even if you can't see fire ants on your property.
Well, if you're in a suppression zone and you can't see a nest, but you are in a suppression zone where we would reasonably expect that there would be fire ants, they'll actually dispense what's called a yard treatment kit out to you.
The task force can send you an insect growth regulator. It's tiny pieces of corn grit soaked in soybean oil, which fire ants love.
It's absolutely irresistible to the fire ant. They will ferociously gather that and take it back to the nest and feed that through to the queen. And that's what we really want it to do. And it's very target specific to the fire ant. And what will happen is the colony will collapse.
This growth regulator is for gardeners like me, who haven't found a nest but still want to help the eradication effort before it's too late. The soybean oil bait is designed to only appeal to fire ants. While the growth regulator has no effect on other invertebrates, studies have shown it has a minimal impact on native ants. The damage to native ants is far less than what it would be if fire ants were allowed to grow in the area. Now, that product isn't actually a poison, is it?
No, it's not. It is a pesticide which is highly targeted to the fire ant.
For those who have concerns about applying insect treatments, it's important to note the Australian Pesticides and Veterinary Medicines Authority approves the use of this fire ant treatment and has deemed it safe for people, animals, and the environment.
It's safe for your pets, it's safe for your dog. What isn't safe for your dog is fire ant.
Even if you think you don't have fire ants, it's worth keeping an eye out, not only in the home garden, but in public parks and open spaces as well. And what does the future hold if we fail in containing them?
It's quite a dire consequence if we actually are unable to eradicate this particular super pest. The countries who have not been able to eradicate provide the perfect illustration of just what a future holds if we don't eradicate fire ants.
If there's one thing that should unite Queensland gardeners, it's fire ants. They're dangerous and they threaten all the good things in life. So if you live in a fire ant suppression zone, you can do your bit as a gardener. Report them. It's a vital role we can all play. Fire ants, not in my backyard.